Good afternoon. My name is Jim Langridge from the Waters Corporation. I'm director of the Pharmaceutical and Life Sciences Discovery business. And I'm going to talk to you about this poster, which is the application of a multi-omic and functional network analysis for paediatric patients diagnosed with idiopathic nephrotic syndrome. So idiopathic nephrotic syndrome results from the malfunction of the glomerular filter and is the most prevalent kidney disease in children. And in spite of some of the progress, its pathogenesis is still unknown, and therapy intervention in this disease is really confined to gross immune modulation of the patient. Therefore, despite the fact there's a variety of methods of for diagnostic and treatment purposes, there's a fundamental lack of understanding of the biology and the pathogenic mechanisms underlying this disease. So we were interested in really using our state-of-the-art analytical approaches from Waters Corporation to really look at this disease and to understand if we can identify some of the molecular mechanisms underpinning the disease. So figure one shows a kidney cross-section, highlighting in the circle here the structure of the kidney, where we have the glomerulus. And it's the glomerulus here which really is impacted by this disease, idiopathic nephrotic syndrome, in young children. And the approach we took is to take 10 samples from patients, from young children with this disease, 10 control patients, and to really use this sample preparation and experimental design shown here. So we had a patient urine, 10 controls and 10 diseases. We used protein concentration and purification here, so we depleted the urine from albumin, and then each one of these was subjected to tryptic digestion prior to analysis by a label-free LCMS based approach. And we then performed qualitative and quantitative analysis of the proteins, really to distinguish changes which are occurring in the disease patients compared to the controls. We also ran metabolite-based analysis of these samples as well, so that we could really correlate changes which were occurring both at the metabolite level and also at the protein level. In terms of the LCMS conditions we used for this particular analysis, we used, as shown in figure three here, shows our data-independent HDMS to the E approach, using a UPLC coupled with our SYNAPT G2S mass spectrometer. So as molecules are eluting from the HPLC or UPLC system into the mass spectrometer, and we quite simply switch between a low energy and an elevated energy on the gas cell in subsequent scans, and we alternate between those two scans. And this allows us to get molecular ion information in the low energy spectrum, and in the elevated energy spectrum, we then get the fragment ions which are associated to those molecular entities. We can then use retention time to correlate the peptides to their fragments, as is shown on the right-hand side. And the real advantage of the SYNAPT system is that we can increase the specificity of that alignment by using ion mobility spectrometry, so we can do ion mobility separation of the peptides prior to fragmentation, as is shown in the bottom of figure three. All of the data was subsequently processed with our informatics package, using both ProteinLink's global server, but primarily our transomics package. And we also used statistical analysis with Easy Info, and then subsequently took the metabolites and proteins of interest and mapped those onto networks and pathways, biological pathways, using the Ingenuity pathway analysis software. So in terms of the results from this study, I think we can quite clearly, as is shown in figure four here, shows the scores plots from OPLSDA analysis of the disease-related samples compared to the controls. These are the urine samples. And what you can see, this is the protein-based scores plot on the top, where we can clearly differentiate the disease patients from the controls, the disease patients being in red, the controls being in black here. And then in the bottom, we have the metabolites, and again, we can clearly differentiate the metabolites, the controls in black, and the patients again in red, we can clearly differentiate those from another. So the changes which we can determine both at the protein and at the metabolite level clearly allow us to differentiate each one of these samples from one another. Another way of us really looking at this plot and starting to, I guess, dig into the results to really identify what components are changing is to use the hierarchical clustering approach, as is shown in the top of figure 5 here. And hierarchical clustering really allows us to start differentiating not just patients from each other, but really understanding how those patients are related. Do disease patients correlate together better than control patients? And we can start to see, as is shown here, at the protein level. So each one of these is a protein, each one of these is a sample in the on this axis. And what you can see is if we go to this highlighted region here with the yellow boxes, this particular protein and this particular feature of this protein is actually upregulated in the disease sample compared to the control. And that's shown in the bottom page here from our transomics software, where you can quite clearly see this is downregulated in the control sample here, so this isotope cluster is downregulated for this particular peptide, this particular feature. And in the disease pretreated sample, you can see that there's quite a substantial elevation in that peptide. At a metabolite level, figure 6 really allows us to see the typical S-plot that we use in a metabolomics analysis, which really identifies those features which in fact differentiate one sample set from the other. So these are highlighted in blue here. These outliers, so to speak, are really the differentiating features at the metabolite level. And you can see we can, in fact, look at those which are going down in the disease patient, such as phenylalanine and glutamate, and those which are upregulated in the disease patients, which, in fact, in this particular case, is uridine. A further way that we can then really take these metabolites is then to map them in terms of their functional analysis. Shows us each of the metabolites, which are then ordered into their functional groups. So in this particular case, we can now look at whether metabolites are up or down regulated based upon their function. And we can see that the blue here, the dark blue, shows that in fact neurological disease related metabolites was down regulated compared to the disease patients, whereas connective tissue disorders, inflammatory disease, and skeletal and muscular disorders is actually those metabolites, related metabolites, are upregulated in the disease patients, as might be expected. We can take this one step further and take these metabolites and proteins and actually utilize these in ingenuity pathway analysis, as is shown in figure 8, which really allows us to start mapping those metabolites and proteins onto biological pathways and to understand their interconnectivity in terms of their role in the their biological role and biological function. So what we can see here in dark green are those proteins which are downregulated, and the in red are the upregulated functions with the intensities associated to them. Around the border of this pathway analysis, we can see categories identified as important in kidney disease, and such as chronic fatigue syndrome and neurological signs, which are highlighted on the outside of the figure. The identified proteins also indicate a relationship to HDL trafficking and composition, and this is presented really in figure 9 here, which ultimately leads to kidney dysfunction through fat digestion and absorption pathways. And the consequence of this is to promote really lipid accumulation in the kidney, and it results in glomerular sclerosis, for example. So in conclusion, 80% of the proteins identified in this study were expressed, with 31% of the proteins having a maximum fold change of greater than 2. The majority of the proteins in this study were glycosylated, and in fact a lot of those glycosylated proteins also show relative fold changes, show abundance changes in the disease condition. We can use statistical tools such as PCA, principal component analysis, that shows quite clearly differentiates at both the protein and the metabolite level, the disease patients from the control patients, and they're highly complementary. And a variety of compounds have been identified which contribute to the metabolic variance, and also a variety of proteins really concur with those metabolites identified. And this label-free multi-omics approach has been applied for the analysis of urine from INS patients and provides both qualitative and quantitative information in a single experiment. Thank you very much.